morning. My name is Nevin Adamyanov, and I'm a medical oncologist. And I know that puts fear into the hearts of many people. Meeting a medical oncologist can be very scary. And I'm going to try to tell you a little bit about what I do. I've been told that I have 10 minutes to speak. That, considering that it took me how many, 20, 30 years to get to this point to kind of learn all about it, it's going to be a bit of a challenge to tell you everything I know in 10 minutes. But at least I'll give you a flavor of how we all participate together to give the best care possible for patients at all stages of cancer. So I'm going to start with colon cancer. I'm going to emphasize just two cancers today. I'm a GI medical oncologist, so my area of specialty is gastrointestinal tumors, things that contribute to the gastrointestinal tract. I'm going to talk a little bit about colon cancer and then a little bit about liver cancer. And the epidemiology, meaning how much cancer do we have in this country, there's a lot of colon cancer in this country. And in terms of malignancies, most people, as you can see, even though they develop colon cancers, most people do not die of colon cancer. So it's one of the success stories of modern medicine. Screening really does make a difference. Now, unfortunately, sometimes colon cancer happens before the standard screening, meaning at the age of 50. But even then, with the advances that we've made in medicine, people are living much longer. 50 to 60% of patients with colon cancer sometimes develop liver metastases when the cancer spreads. And that is where the liver-directed therapy comes in. As I said, in terms of liver metastases, it's the most common site of metastatic disease for colon cancer. The other one is lung cancer. 50 to 75% with advanced colon cancer develop liver metastases. Up to a quarter of people actually come to see me with liver metastases. As Dr. Sudhindra mentioned, we usually talk about everyone in a tumor board. So if the surgeon says, I think I can take out the liver metastases, we certainly say, please, do your best to remove all sites of cancer. We know that if the surgeon can remove all sites of cancer, we have a chance of getting rid of the cancer altogether. And those are the ones who have metastatic disease confined to the liver. At Penn, we also have very aggressive lung surgeons. So if you have a spot in the liver, a spot in the lung, we will frequently send you to both the liver surgeons and the lung surgeons in hopes of getting rid of the cancer altogether. Standard systemic therapy. Systemic means it goes through the whole body and kills cancer cells wherever it might be. That's your standard treatment, usually given intravenously. And here is a huge list. This is why we go to cancer doctor school, to learn about all this. I certainly don't expect you to read it, understand it, but it's a sense to give you a sense of how many options we do have. And these are just the standard options. With the addition of biologic therapy, we add efficacy to standard chemotherapies. So these are great options. These are treatments that keep people living much longer than they did 20 years ago, but they're not curative options, unfortunately. Targeted therapy refers to treatments that target specific proteins on the tumor cells. This is one of the slides that I use for teaching fellows. Again, not something that I expect most people in this room to understand or even care about, but just to give you a sense of what we mean by targeting the tumor. What we are hoping is that as time goes on, we develop treatments that target the tumor and not the normal cells. And you can see in orange, there are several that have been developed in various tumor types that target specific proteins that are present more commonly in tumor cells and not so much in normal cells. One of the common treatments that are used for metastatic colon cancer are what are called epidermal growth factor receptor inhibitors or antibodies, and they can cause a rash. And we can treat that as well. So even though sometimes we can give people targeted therapy to kill the cancer, we can also treat the side effects with relatively easy terms. Liver-directed therapy is used if the cancer is predominantly in the liver. Surgery, if the surgeons can cut it out, we say, please, please do. Ablation, that's what Dr. Sudhinder is going to talk to you about in a few minutes. And then intra-arterial therapies, the yttrium-labeled spheres that can kill cancer cells as well. Just to give you a sense of the differences between the SIR spheres and the chemoembolization. Again, I'm not going to go into this, otherwise I'm not going to be here for less than 10 minutes. The exciting thing is that the SIR spheres have been shown to be even more effective when they're combined with chemotherapy. So instead of doing this just one thing at a time, if you combine chemotherapy with liver-directed therapy, even better things happen. In terms of liver cancer, we do a lot of treatment of liver cancer, and we, just so everyone understands, we differentiate between liver cancer, so cancer that starts in the liver or hepatocellular carcinoma, and cancer that has spread to the liver, which we call metastases to the liver. So on an X-ray, on an MRI or a CAT scan, or for that matter a PET scan, they may look exactly the same, but on a biopsy under the microscope they're quite different, and we use different treatments to treat those two tumors. Liver cancer, unfortunately, is rising in prevalence, meaning there's more and more liver cancer out there. Some of it is because the predisposing factors are becoming more common. Hepatitis, obesity, things that predispose people to scarring of the liver or cirrhosis. Cirrhosis is not just due to alcohol. Most people get very upset if I say, oh, you have cirrhosis. I just mean scarring of the liver. I don't actually mean you're lush. Just so that everyone understands, okay? And nowadays, a lot of them are, as I said, due to hepatitis. We know that there are some things that cause us to be a little bit more wary about these cancers. These are the things that predict a more aggressive course. And again, as Dr. Sudhinder mentioned, we talk about people behind their backs on a regular basis. Every Friday morning at 7 a.m., we all get together, the medical oncologist, the radiation oncologist, the surgical oncologist, the interventional radiologist, and the team that supports them, and decide what is the best treatment for the patient we're talking about. Radioembolization is the use of yttrium to kill cancer cells. It is injected into the liver and works mostly by delivering directed radiation to the liver. And there are several kinds, and they work quite well for tumors that are located in the liver. The problem is that they don't go outside the liver. For those cancers, what we call advanced or metastatic hepatocellular carcinoma, we tend to use, again, systemic therapy. Plain old chemotherapy, the kind that works for cancers that have spread to the liver, unfortunately doesn't work for cancer that has started in the liver. So there we have very limited options in those situations. And that is why, and one of my favorite soapboxes, I would encourage anyone who's approached to participate in a clinical trial to strongly consider clinical trial participation. Not just because it is an altruistic thing to do, but because we can always do standard things later, while the opportunity to participate in the clinical trial may go away with time. It is, for the most part, especially in the first line setting, meaning upon diagnosis, we tend not to use sugar pills or placebos. Certainly you will be informed if there is a placebo control. Most of the time in liver cancers, in the first line setting where we have sorafenib, we do not use placebo. Sorafenib is an FDA-approved medication that's used for the treatment of cancers that are no longer resectable, that cannot be cut out. It is a treatment in pill form. However, let me be clear, it's not Tylenol. It is more toxic. But it seems to work quite well in allowing people to live much longer with liver cancer than they would have otherwise. Sorafenib, or Nexavar, is a targeted therapy. It doesn't kill as many normal cells as regular chemotherapy, but as I said, by no means is it something that should be taken lightly. And we have developed a way of increasing the doses slowly to really minimize toxicity. And just a plug for a clinical trial that we have open at Penn. Several clinical trials have been shown not to have a benefit. This is in the first line setting, and this is in the second line setting. Some of them are ongoing. This is the one that is open at Penn, the tivantinib trial. And it targets the protein called MET. And it is only appropriate for people whose tumors have a high proportion of MET on the surface of the tumor. So this does require a biopsy to test the tumor to see whether the MET is overexpressed on the surface. If the MET is found to a great degree on the surface, then this is a clinical trial. It is only appropriate for people who have already been on sorafenib therapy. We know that high MET expression portends a poor prognosis, and with treatment with tivantinib, we believe by making MET less prominent, people have a longer survival, but that is what we're trying to show. This is a placebo-controlled trial. It is in the second-line setting. Remember, nothing has been shown to be better than what we call best supportive care in the second-line setting. So this is an ethical trial. Twice as many people will get tivantinib as placebo, and we're hoping to have the trial completely enrolled within the next year or so and show the benefit of that. If indeed it shows a benefit, then the drug will go to FDA and hopefully be approved within the next several years. Thank you for your attention, and I greatly appreciate the opportunity to speak here about these tumors.